And, at least for this session, maybe through the two. The title that we have up here is The Heart of the Eternal Plan. And I'm fond of this word, heart, because I see that it is, it's important. It's important. It's important to God. It's important to us. It's important to one another. But as we're talking about the eternal plan, we're seeing the heart of the Father. We see the heart of the Father before the foundation of the world. And this is some scriptures we've looked at in Ephesians and Hebrews and different places. And we begin to discover that that the Father, his part in this is that he created the world, and there was something that he wanted to get out of it. And it wasn't just sinless people or perfect people. Certainly not perfect people, because Adam and Eve were able to sin right off. He also has foreknowledge, so he knew that. But there was something in his heart that through a process, an ugly process, of which I will not speak, but that's where the Holy Spirit has me. He would gain sons, and so we could draw it up just this representing sons. And so this was in his heart. So this is in his heart, and he creates man, and nobody knows that. They don't even know he's a father. I mean, it took, you know, tons of millennia to get past just God, just God. He's God. This is so, now there were those who found him beyond that, and this is where you get the names of God. This is where you get a progression toward him, and it all is leading, every time I can think of that someone recognized God beyond just God, they built an altar. They built an altar and called that altar after his name. And, it'd be so easy to just go where he's sharing with me right now, but that's not my goal. But the goal here for just people, before they recognize what's in his heart, their goal is to find the heart of the Father so that they can pursue not just being people, or religious people, you know, not just people and not just religious people, but pursuers of the heart, what is in the heart of the Father. Okay, so that progression, just biblically, was a long progression. But you have people, even before the New Testament, you have people. David, I mean, David's a perfect example. David was a man after God's heart. He wasn't a man after God's will. And he wasn't a man after God's interests, if you put those interests in terms of anything other than what's really in his heart. Jesus is called the Son of David, right? Did y'all know that? The Son of David. You ever, you know, ever look at that and kind of go, why is he the son of David? He was around way before David. But as it were, becoming the son of man, he has a heart and he's identified as one like David, who Jesus's heart is going to be after the Father. Okay? He's going to have a heart after God. So Jesus is son of man now. So there is this reality that we must find his heart. His heart is that we find that and become sons in the image of the Son. For that to happen, the Son has to be the mediator. The Son has to be the mediator between God and man. But he's not mediating salvation alone, not the way we think of it. It's not just mediating, oh, y'all, you know, God had big plans for you, but you got off track, and I'm going to get you back and saved. And, you know, Jesus is the only true mediator that can mediate this thing that's in the Father's heart for sons, so that they, by him, but not by his actions, by him. See, and we're always looking at the actions of God. We're always looking at, well, do something, Lord. Oh, Lord, touch me. Or, oh, Lord, fix this. Or, oh, Lord, do this. Or do that. Or do that. And so I'm sure it was astonishing to the Jews when Jesus said, I am the way, I am the bread of life, I am the true vine, I am, you know, and he just kept at it. I am that. I have always meant to be that. I am that way. No man comes to the Father but by me. So we're talking now, of course, by the Father. Coming to the Father, but there is a tendency to always view everything in relationship to what we've done wrong. So thank God for Jesus. And that's true. But what if when Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, let's just say it like this. What if when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, he wasn't talking about mediating our salvation? He was talking about getting to the Father, coming to the Father, coming to the Father, not coming to God, coming to the Father, coming to the Father. I am this son, and what he wants to be in my image, that you might be conformed to the image of his son. Okay? So to bring that about, there has to be another heart. There has to be a heart that has worked into these people to want that, but there has to be a heart in Jesus to be that. At whatever expense, no, see, we know that whatever expense in relationship to salvation. But at whatever expense to get us to the Father. So, for this to work, for this to actually, really, not theologically, not as we're sitting here talking, but to actually be brought to pass, it's got to be a heart thing all the way through. Do you see that? It has to be a heart thing all the way through, up and down, up and down. It can't be theological. It can't be that. It can't be religious. It can't be it can't be focused and centralized in lives, let me draw it out here. So this is the same picture of people knowing they need, you know. But we centralize that in us without really necessarily having a heart. Let me just ask you this. Do you believe that there are people who have gotten saved that really don't have a heart after God? They just want to be saved from hell. You know? Might have been some of us. I mean, you know, it can happen, but then you begin to develop something. As long as you remain as a child, and we're not ready to fully discuss that yet, but as long as you remain a child, then you're going to centralize everything in you. You're going to see it based on your life. Your life is going to be Christian in this world instead of Christ. Can't get around it. So that's what it's going to be. It's not going to be in Son under the Father. It's going to be Christian in this world. And therefore, everything is going to float or to move or be focused or find its centrality in you. In you. You'll read everything in light of you. Every scripture, you know, the good man does this, but the evil man does that. Proverbs, we'll always be the good man. When Jesus is the good man, and we're the evil ones. Okay? And so that's just a very small example, but just in our daily living, not just how we read the Bible or how we theologically dissect it, which will always be dissected in our favor, and guess what? And against our enemies. Our enemies. Been meditating on that scripture in Psalm 110, verse 1, that says that the Lord will make your enemies your footstool. And as I thought about it, I just laughed for a while, because I said, you know, everybody has enemies. And everybody that's a Christian is going to turn that against their enemies, so that God's going to do this for me, right? So it's going to be, you know, my enemies are going to make their enemies their footstool, which is me. Which means we all end up being a footstool. I mean, it's wrong. It's a wrong. We run on tracks that take us to wrong places and to wrong conclusions. And we're if we're devoid of this heart, then we're just out here. God. The great God, he is there to be prayed to, and he's there to be to fix the problems, which are, I don't even know, I'm stupid for even saying that, 99% problems of a carnal existence. But how would we know that? We wouldn't call, you know, the good man, the Lord will bless the good man, but the evil man shall be punished or something. We wouldn't call me saying that I'm the good man carnal Christianity, but it is. You could call it humanism. It's focused on the human. It's focused on self. It's focused on how this thing's going to work for me. All right, so all of that aside, when God wanted to bring something about, when the Father wanted sons, and when the Son wanted one after his kind, the wife of the Lamb, In no way did they just want that theologically, or for us to agree to that and say, okay. He wanted us to move, well, thank you, Holy Spirit. Over in 1 Corinthians, of course, I want you to stay in John, so keep your place there, but let's see if I can find it. I tell you, you know, sometimes the word tastes so good, I just take a bite out of it. You see that? He said, eat the word. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Verse 9, but as it is written, eye hath not seen, nor ear heard, neither have entered into the heart of man the things which God hath prepared for them that love him, that love him, that love him. Now that's a weird phrase if you put that in normal everyday Christianity. You know what I mean? I mean, because that's a heart thing. That's not, well, I will reveal it to you if you will seek. Okay, yes, yes, yes. But see, he's wanting you to seek because he's saying there's stuff to be revealed. And those things are referred in the scriptures below as the deep things of God. The deep things of God. Okay, well, God doesn't have things. You know what I mean? It's not like he's got, you know, trinkets and gadgets and, you know, knickknacks and stuff like that up in heaven. There are no, and there's no deep version of that. There's only the things that make up God in his heart. Those are the deep things of God. He doesn't have, you know, well, I want to tell you about my ranch or, you know, something like that. He's not going to go there. It's going to be those things that are deep within his heart that I have not seen and cannot see unless there's a heart condition that begins to be worked there for those that love him, for those that love him. I'm pretty sure he can tell who it is that loves him and who it is that serves out of fear and who it is that is just going through the motions and who it is that likes religion and who it is that, you know what I mean? There's all these categories. But Jesus loves the Father unto death. And so this group will never develop that heart in and of themselves. They're going to have to enter into someone where it's real, where it's real, where it's already at work, where you don't have to work it up, but that's going to happen in Son. Yes?
That kicked on right when you were speaking. You said that these sons, I don't know if you think that happened to repeat what you just said, these sons here.
So you didn't hear that because the air conditioner kicked on? These sons are just going to go to hell. That's all. Oh, no, wait a minute. That's not what I said. Okay. These sons do not have this innately in them. They're not going to have this in them. They're going to have it in him. They're going to have it in Son. They're going to have it by the one that loves him. What did the Father call him? The Son of the Father's love. The Son of my love. The Son of the Father's love. There is this union that is not based, and that's not when we say love. We're not talking about an emotion. We're talking about a seeking that's more than a seeking. It's a deep yearning to be with him where he's at, not to get him where you're at, which is pretty much what Christianity is, trying to get God where we're at. Oh, Jesus, we're praying. You know, the prayer is sort of to get him down here, or at least leave him on the throne and let him throw down an answer. And he does that, and he's fine. The satisfaction of his heart is when there is a desire to know him, to know God beyond the God we know. And we're not talking about an addition of deeper knowledge. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about sort of throwing out the God we know, as it were, and pursuing him as we don't know. Eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, neither has entered into the heart of man the deep things of God, the things that are deep in God. So there is a driving force that begins to be formed in you. That driving force is not guilt. That driving force is not religion or competition within religion, like Paul outdoing his fellow Pharisees, as it says in Galatians 1, or any other thing on that mode. It is it's where you it's where, let's say that you have to share with people. And so it's going to happen in the morning. And so you get your period of time the next day, and you set aside your Bible as a book for messages, and you pick up a new Bible, and you say, I just want to know you as you want to be known, not as I've been taught by Randy or anyone else. Do you understand that? That's important. Not as I got it from him, not as I heard him speak or anyone else. I want to know you in the way that you want to be known. Okay, now if that's said right and in the right spirit, it's coming from the Son who is going to lift you out of you and your carnal, glass ceiling that you can't get past. And it's going to open you up, you see? It's going to open you up in ways that you couldn't be open even by all your trying and trying to get a heart after God and all that kind of stuff. It's not going to happen. It doesn't happen. It happens when you start breaking out of religion and you start breaking out of you and you start breaking out of what you've been taught. And let me clarify that. I'm not, whatever you've been taught, wherever you came from, I'm not saying that's wrong. I am not saying that's wrong. I'm saying that after a certain juncture for a child, you can never grow up if every meal you eat is in Chuck E. Cheese. You think this is it? You know, you're 27, jumping in the ball pool, throwing it at other little kids. You know. See me after class. Notice she didn't flinch at all. She's not scared.
He's taking you to Chuck E. Cheese.
And then driving off. So, you know, it's in one sense it's ridiculous for me to stand up here and talk about this. It really is. But on the other hand, how shall they hear without a preacher, you know? And You know, I love the story of Job for that reason. This, the very things I've said, everything I've said, the story of Job is perfect because you got these three guys that know it, know everything, and they're quoting scripture like crazy. You know what I mean? They're quoting scripture. I mean, and it sounds good, and it sounds right, and it sounds, but it doesn't sound. It sounds like banging a gong, you know, sounding brass. Gang, gang, gang. You ever heard a drummer? Well, you will Sunday. Anyway, that will just bang on the. Just kidding. I'm proud to say that I'll be leading worship Sunday morning, and the thing that I'm proud about it is Noah's going to be playing the drums. But it's, and here's why it sounds not, it just doesn't reach you, is because nobody can reach you but the Holy Spirit. Ultimately, nobody can reach you. I do believe in seeds. I do believe that. I believe that you can share the word and seeds can go in you and God will bring them up in his time, you know. But God's the one who gives the increase. See, yes, one plants, one waters, but God gives that increase. But what is that increase? That increase is the increase of the seeds, the seed that has been planted within you. So we need one another. We need the body. And, you know, he says he gave some this and that till we all come to the, you know, measure the stature, the fullness of Christ. But we have a tendency to lean toward preferences. Well, I prefer, you know, this person to share or that person to share. But our hearts are not there. If our heart is there at all, it's only there for one person that we prefer. But in truth, it's not. Because the heart is going to be open to find the Lord through whosoever mouth speaks. That's just right. You don't have to have preferences. You have the Holy Spirit. That's the truth. That's the truth. So, I guess I should start sharing here. Let's go back to John 6. I don't know. The reason why I got off on that was the word heart. I walked up there and I saw the heart of the eternal plan, and I realized that the heart of the eternal plan depends on every heart lining up, you know, in the manner in which we may gain Christ, and in so doing, give the Father what satisfies him, sons in the image of Christ. Okay, John chapter 6, and we did verse 29. I want to reread it again, then we'll drop down to where we left off. This is John 6, 29. Jesus answered and said unto them, "This is the work of God, that you believe on him whom he hath sent." All right. So, you know, again, I don't know how many of you that scripture's ever bothered you. It's bothered me a lot, you know. They're going, "Well, we want to work the works of God." And he says, you know, okay. But then the Holy Spirit just breathes on it. That breath comes in you, and all of a sudden you look at it and you go, "Oh my God, he's not saying believe on Jesus or believe on God or believe there is a God," which is just about as small a belief system as you can get. Well, just to believe there is a God, but to believe on the one he has sent, which is this broken bread, Jesus. But to believe on him, and you do know that the word believe most of the time, as far as I know, means believe into, right? Believe into him, which is sort of contrary to the way believing him is all about. But to believe into him, well, what does that mean? Oh my God, it means believe into the one he sent, and then sonship or the son begins to be formed in us, because there are no works of God that will please God except believing into him and letting the son do it. Jesus said that all throughout John, in chapter 5, in the chapter just in front of this, you know. The works I do are not my own. The words I speak are not my own. It's the Father. See? And that's it. He's captivating us. He's not just, you know, he's not just doing a house call. You know, not. Just like to come in, sit down with you, talk with you about Jesus. You are Jesus. He's captivating us. So they're looking, they're totally outside the heart when they say this. So, you know, tell us what to do that we might work the works of God. He's going to believe on this broken bread, and if you believe into it, it's going to be in you, because that's where he goes after this. Right after this, he just starts pouring into that thing. I and you and me, you know, eat my flesh and drink my blood. Put me in you, and you will do the works of God. It will be effortless if you didn't have a carnal mind. Because every step you go, what is this guy? Should I do this? I don't know if I, you know. And I think the Father just goes like this. Look, if I listen to every one of you all day long, I will go crazy. So I'm going to believe for you. God help us. Yeah, thank you, Lord. Amen. Amen. Because, I mean, our minds can just roll and roll, can't they? I mean, my Lord, just, well, you know, I mean, even when we're trying, you know, well, what does that mean? And Lord, when are you going to show me? And what is the revelation of Christ? And what is the, and it's like, he's going, don't you love the scripture? Be still and know that I'm God. Well, what does that mean? I don't know. You know, it would be effortless if we didn't have a carnal mind that was trying, you know, and our mind a lot of times is seeking to grasp instead of seeking him. Amen. Seeking to grasp. I want to grasp that. I have not seen. You're not going to grasp it. I mean, does that make sense? Ear hath not heard. It hasn't entered into your heart. But God hath revealed it unto us by his Spirit. So that's going to be the avenue. So, you know, you just calm yourself down and you say, you know what, Holy Spirit, you're going to have to reveal this in me. And you're going to have to reveal that Son. And when that Son is in me, then I believe the heart that will satisfy the Father will be in all of us that conform to that image. And that, you know, and I've told him, I'm telling you, I've told the Holy Spirit many times, look, this is not my job. This is your job. People say, you shouldn't talk to the Holy Spirit like that. He loves it because I'm looking to him instead of, you know, it may be a stupid, randy way of doing it, but he, you know, sometimes he just kind of mushes my hair and says, you little knucklehead, come on, I'll do it then, you know. He's okay. You know, he doesn't, you know, we go, see, some of us couldn't do that. Oh my God, I'd blaspheme the Holy Spirit. And then there's no hope. I can't do that. All right. So, believe on the one whom he sent. Believe on the one whom he sent. Believe on the one he sent to you. Believe into the one. So verse 38 is where we actually left off last time. For I came down from heaven. All right, well, that's going to mess with Jews. Right? That's going to mess with some Jews there. You came down from heaven. What? What's she talking about, Willis? I came down from heaven. Not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. Oh, my God, there's him that sent me again. But he's putting it on a different basis than verse 29. It's really not a different basis, but it's a further explanation of what this thing is about. He's not just saying, I was sent of God. I am a messenger from God. And I've heard preachers stand and go, I am a messenger from God, and this is, okay. Well, as long as you don't read past verse 29, you're okay with that. But verse 38, for I came not down from heaven, not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me. I am not here for me. All right. So remember, this is in the midst of it's starting to get sort of weird. Jesus fed the 5,000. Then they started talking about making him a prophet and a king, and he just disappeared. Then they figure out where he is, and they hunt him down. And then Jesus says, look, your motives are not my motives. Your heart is not my heart. Your way is not my way. Your thoughts are not my thoughts. And they're going, well, then just tell us what to do, and we'll do it. You ever heard that before?
Yeah.
Israel said that at Mount Sinai. His sending was for one purpose and one purpose alone. Not to be sent to the people so that they would all da-da-da-da. He was sent to bring about the satisfaction of the Father. Isn't that cool?
Yeah.
I mean, that's cool. Because, I mean, the reason why I'm saying that's cool is I'm trying to show you a contrast to that of what being sent to most people means. And it's all wrapped up in themselves. And it's all wrapped up in position. Or it's all wrapped up in being something great to the people or something. Are you following me? Y'all know this, don't you? this is the common view of this kind of thing. But Jesus, on the other hand, he's going, I'm sent not to do my own will. It's not about me. I'm here to bring about the satisfaction of the Father. And he knows what he's talking about. He knows where that's going to lead to. It's going to lead to the cross. Okay, so he's going to decrease in this process. The Son is going to be weakened, at least in the eyes of men. He's going to be brought down low. He's going to be accused by the religious people of blaspheming God, and he is God. And for those of you who are God and somebody blasphemes you and says you're against God and you know you're God, you know how upset you can get. But Jesus didn't, because he's here for the satisfaction of the Father. Okay, so one of the things that we can conclude in this is that there's a possibility to actually bring forth the satisfaction of the Father. Jesus is not going, his satisfaction is not supposed to be at issue. Right? Okay. Well, when you talk over here in relationship to what Jesus wanted, well, he wanted one after his kind. He wanted a wife of the Lamb. That's for his satisfaction. But he's not working towards that. The father, remember the story in Genesis, the father Abraham is sending Eliezer, the Holy Spirit, down into Haran to bring back a bride for the son. The father's doing all of that. And he's working with the Holy Spirit. You don't see Isaac over there going, "Now, Dad, here's what I'm looking for. She's got to be brown-eyed," because they all are. But she's got to have blonde hair, you know, and look like Shakira. No, he's not there at all. Some of you look like you're slipping a little bit, and I thought I'd get you with that. No, the son really isn't even in the picture. Isn't that interesting? He's not there dictating his desires. That's what I'm trying to point out. He's not saying, "This will satisfy me." He's depending on the Father and the Holy Spirit to know what is in him because they're one. Glory to God. You see? So what does that mean? So here's our view of the son then. Okay, well, he's in the tent over here, and he's just, you know, he's got his feet propped up, you know, zero gravity chair, and he's checking out the sports, you know, and stuff like that. We don't hear about him. I'll tell you exactly where he is. He's like right here walking around saying, "Eat my flesh and drink my blood, because by taking me into you, then together we will satisfy the Father." It wasn't focusing on that, so it didn't tell us that. This tells us that the heart of the Son is for the Father's satisfaction. That's the proof. We can know that because the Father is not dictating to the Son, is he? He's talking to the Holy Spirit. Go down there, get a bride for the Son. You know, it's like he's got his own world, but his world is his Son. Well, Jesus, you can be assured, he's over here doing the same thing, and he's saying, "I am going to be put in a condition where you can take me in to you." Well, he knows that's the cross. He knows it's broken bread and poured out blood. But, you know, you're not going to be able to break off an arm of Jesus and, you know, chew on it. That's not what he's talking about. Erase that picture from your mind. But that's not it. That's not, see, he's the whole spirit of this is that he's going to be made in such a manner that you can take him in and you can assimilate him into your being. Okay? All right. So that's what the cross is all about, folks. That doesn't happen just by revelation. It is a revelation of Christ crucified. Okay? You need to always connect those two. Revelation is never, there's not a revelation of God apart from the cross. The cross was meant to be the revelation of God. God is love, right? It didn't say God is righteousness. He is not righteousness. He is righteous in his being, but he is love. And by this perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us. That's how you perceive the love of God, is the cross. That's how you perceive God. That's how you begin to understand God. Okay, so. And it's interesting that Paul, who seems to be, I was going to say seems to be God's favorite writer, but seems to have tapped into the heart of God. He never mentions any miracles in the Gospels. I mean, he lived during that time. Come on. I mean, he was around. He never mentions any of that. He never mentions, any of the real teachings. I mean, the only real teaching I can remember that he mentions of Jesus. Anybody know what it is? No, well, that's true. That's right. That's good. I was thinking of as the Lord said, give and it shall be given unto you. Isn't that interesting? That's a real direct quote of Jesus with all the other stuff Jesus said. Why didn't he jump on, he's the vine, we're the branches, and just go with that? Everything he saw, he didn't get it from the apostles who heard it. You know, he says that in Galatians. I didn't get it. Spent 15 days with James, the brother, and then left. He says, the gospel that I preach came by the revelation of Christ. Okay. So he doesn't, he's not preaching anything by the Sea of Galilee. He's not preaching, he's not preaching Bethlehem. He's not he's preaching the cross. Am I right or wrong? He's preaching the cross. Because why? Because there we're going to encounter the living God. There. That's where we're going to find out who he is. We're going to know him beyond the creator being. Yeah. God, the one, if he's God, then he's powerful. And that's where our minds go immediately. We don't go to his heart. We go to his hands. We go to what he can do. All right, so Jesus says, I've come. Okay, so usually when someone is sent, they don't tell you why they're not sent. You know what I mean? They just tell you why they were sent. But he says, I've come not to do. There's certain things I'm not going to do. Isn't that good? I mean, because of the boisterousness of our own ways and stuff, it's, I've come to help you, to set you free, to do all of this. And Jesus is so after the heart of the Father. He does not want to encroach on anything that could siphon off something that should be going to the Father. I've come not to do. Can you see that that's foremost in his mind, just as much as, basically not my will but thine be done. It's foremost in his mind not to do things. Well, he didn't say, well, I've come not to sin or to, do stuff I shouldn't. He says, I've come to not to do what satisfies me, but what satisfies him. All right, so that's a difficult one for us, because we get so focused on the sending or on the message because I believe we all hear from God. I believe, and when I say we all, I'm not just talking about in this room or on Skype. I mean, in general, people in churches hear from God. I believe we hear from God with our message. But I don't believe we've heard enough from God to realize that there's also some things we're not supposed to be doing. while we deliver our message. Are y'all following that? And the only one we can look to is the Son. Amen. And then the Son and Paul, and then, you know, on and on and on. I mean, that's our only hope. That's our only hope. Christ in you is our only hope. But because it's been allowed that it be about the message, then the messenger, in an effort to get the message across, may cross lines that take away from the one we're talking about. I'm sure all of us at some time or another have heard that. Maybe you're listening to it right now. But there needs to be in working of the Son.
Yes.
See, not just a understanding, okay, so this is my not side and this is my do side, you know. And I'll, you know, and I understand. I'm the one who wrote the not but thing, you know, not I but Christ, and on and on and on. And it's throughout the scriptures, and it's true, and it's valid. It's incredibly valid, that not but thing. And we see it again here with Jesus. Not. For I came from heaven not to do, not mine own will, but, there it is. There's always that which we cannot do lest we violate Christ, and that which we are called and sent to do. Anyway, okay. What we see there then is that they're saying, because you got to remember, see, we're not moving real fast here, but there's the context going on here. What's that context? The context is that they, the people that are all around him, and people are all around him during this time, he's talking to people, and they're just got through saying, you know, send manna from heaven, give us bread from heaven, show us how we could do that kind of stuff. That's what they're referring to. Show us how we can do that kind of stuff. And Jesus detects that the central focus is again on themselves while they're trying to get God to satisfy them. He is telling them it's not about me being satisfied, but the Father. He wants the satisfaction of the Father. That's what's at work in him. At work in him. It's at work. It's working within him. It is controlling, and it is him, but it is controlling thoughts without effort. It is because it's a determined, it's a focused thing. It is first, the Father is first. Everything else, anything that violates that is not acceptable. Okay, because it works in him and it orders thoughts and it takes away other thoughts. It casts them down and it causes certain wordings and certain things to come forth, and it causes certain other things, wordings not to come forth, and it is the mind of Christ. It's the mind of Christ. Let this mind be in you who thought it not a thing to be grasped after, to be equal with God. So, it's not about the Son being satisfied. Then verse 39, and this is the Father's will who hath sent me. Notice, do you notice that he keeps talking about the Father and he keeps talking about being sent? This is the Father's will who sent me, that of all that he hath given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up again at the last day. So this is his will. This is his will. That the Father's will is that he wants sons that come out of death and are raised up with Christ in him at the last day. At the last day. Didn't we see this last day thing somewhere else? We'll see it again. We'll see it again. Because it keeps coming up because in the mind of Jesus, see, Jesus isn't, he's not looking around and going, you know, I wonder how long, how many more days we got left before God's going to end this thing. He doesn't think like that. He thinks in terms of, well, the last day is the cross. This is going to end all of us. And we'll see that in a latter verse where it'll say it again. So it'll specifically show that. But I'm giving you a little pre-thing here. His way of viewing is the heart of the Father. The thing that's going to be necessary to bring that about is the cross. And the joy of the Father at the last day when those are raised up in him and the Father receives those sons by Christ. And the Father, the Son, as it were, his satisfaction then is what? The Father's satisfaction. That's what's in his heart. And so raise it up. See, Jesus isn't going to raise it up. He's not going to go, okay, raise up. It's going to be raised up in him. See, but he knows it's going to be raised up in him out of death. That's the cost to him to satisfy the Father. Well, folks, isn't that true of us? Is it? Yes. I am crucified. This is Paul's version of it. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. We have every right, every Christian on the planet and has ever been and ever will be, has every right to say, Jesus died so I can live. Everyone has a right to say that. You know why? Because Jesus died so they can live. But every Christian that has ever been and ever will be also should come to the same spirit that took him to the cross. See, the cross isn't two pieces of wood, folks. The cross is a spirit called the Spirit of the Lamb. That's how we refer to it. And so we have a right to say, Jesus died so I can live, but we are supposed to gain the family spirit. See, we say, well, I'm a child of God. Well, do you have the family spirit? Well, no, that's why I said I'm a child. I can get away with stuff, you know. Well, but see, sons, that's a different ball game. Sons, how beautiful to the Father, not just male whatever, you know, but sons is that spirit that says, like Paul said, I now am crucified that he would live. He died and was crucified that I would live. Now I lay down what he gave me freely. I lay that down so that he can live. You see that with Abraham. You see that with Abraham. Take now thy son, thine only son, the only begotten, the only one that exists like this, and take him up there and crucify him. Take him up there and offer him up. And Abraham goes up there and is in the heart of the Father, he gave his son. God stopped him. And from that day on, to Abraham and to God, he didn't see him as the only begotten anymore. This was the son that was given, you see. But in that picture, we also see the heart of the Father. The Father wants sons in the image of Christ, but guess what? The Father, see, just, you know, just as there is a heart in the Father and a heart drawn in the Son and then a heart drawn around us as sons, there's also a cross in the heart of the Father and in the Son and in us. And the heart of the Father, the cross in relationship to the Father is, we don't even get that. But he gave his only begotten Son. You know. We don't know what that means. But there had to be a cross at work in him to do that. There had to be a cross. Just as there was a cross at work in Jesus, if you will, you understand what I'm saying, to go to that those two pieces of wood nailed together and to lay down his life. And, you know, it's the same for the Holy Spirit. We say, why has the Holy Spirit got all this power? Because we're always, you know, well, he did this and he moved that and he changed this and he healed this and he da-da-da-da. And he's got all this power and everything. Because he dies so much that he is totally unseen. He is totally unrecognized. He is totally out of the picture, as it were, in a real tangible way so that we could do anything with him. He's self-giving, lifting up Christ. That's what his main focus is, to lift up Christ. But, boy, you go down in death and power comes out. And it works in the Father, and it works in the Son, and it works in the Holy Spirit, because they're all God. They're one Spirit. They're one. We are told to focus on the Son because, why? He's the door into the Father and the Holy Spirit. He's the door into the oneness that is God. He is. He's the door. Well, yes, I think he said that. I am the door. Anyway, let's see. Just this final thing, because I skipped it at the very first when I was talking about sending him, and it said that three different times since we've been reading here. God didn't just send a God. He sent his Son. And he knew what we would do to his Son. And Jesus knew also. But he wanted the satisfaction of the Father. And it was his heart to give up whatever he had, that the Father would get what he wants. And he did. And that's that Spirit. I am crucified so that Christ may live, instead of him being crucified so I may live. I want that reverse right now. I don't want it to be about me. I want it to be about him. Amen? All right, let's stop and take a break.